Taking place tonight at George Washington University's Cloyd Heck Marvin Center is the annual Cafritz Awards for Distinguished D.C. Government Employees.
Welcome, everybody, to the 13th annual Morris and Gwendolyn Cafritz Foundation Awards for Distinguished D.C. Employees. We welcome all of the friends and family and co-workers. Thank you so much for coming and supporting our finalists and winners. And, of course, we welcome our finalists, and we welcome our five winners. So thank you all for coming. Give yourselves a round of applause as well for being here. We're very aware that you don't get to be a finalist or a winner without lots of support from family and from co-workers and supervisors, from members of the community that support and assist our efforts. So we know that you are sharing in these awards as well. So it's important that you be here. Let me just introduce people who are on stage with me. My name is Jim Robinson. I'm director of the George Washington University Center for Excellence in Public Leadership. And to my far left is Mr. Calvin Cafritz, you'll be hearing from. Next to him is Dr. Bernard Demchuk, who'll be representing the president of the university. And last but not least is Director of Human Resources, Sean Stokes. Thank you all for being here. The Center for Excellence in Public Leadership is so proud to be a part of this award. It is so meaningful for us to see so many worthy candidates, read their stories, get to speak with them on the phone, get to talk with the people who have nominated them. It is very uplifting. It takes you well beyond any Washington Post headline that you might read. So we get to see all the good stuff, the phenomenal work that is being done by employees of the District of Columbia government. And let me just introduce our first speaker. Mr. Calvin Cafritz is a native Washingtonian who has dedicated his life to serving the city of Washington, D.C. as the president and CEO of the Morris and Gwendolyn Cafritz Foundation. The foundation is the largest independent local foundation that focuses solely on Washington, D.C. and its metropolitan area. Under Mr. Cafritz's leadership, the foundation has awarded more than $301 million. And this has helped to underwrite 6,614 projects in the community. Also, the Cafritz Foundation was a founding sponsor and supporter of our center in 1997. And they continue to be a supporter of ours today, enabling us to do the work that we do in serving Washington, D.C. And we are very grateful for that long and sustained relationship and for the confidence that they have placed in our center. So at this point, let me ask Mr. Cafritz to come forward and welcome you to tonight's event. Mr. Cafritz.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you for the kind remark. It's great to be here this evening. We're here this evening to celebrate the 13th annual Cafritz Awards Gala. And on behalf of the board and staff of the Morris and Gwendolyn Cafritz Foundation, I'm delighted to congratulate all of the winners and finalists who are being honored tonight. I would like to acknowledge the presence of a foundation board member, my wife, Jane. I'm very pleased that she's here. Uh, and also our executive director, Roseanne Cleveland, and members of our wonderful staff to my right. Thank you all for coming tonight. This year, the Cafritz Award Program received nominations from over 300 individuals representing 39 different DC offices and departments. Altogether, over 80 applications were submitted and all went through a grueling screening and selection process. We would like to thank both of the independent committees that screened and selected this year's group of finalists and winners. These committees faced a tough challenge, as so many DC government employees are doing exemplary work, often behind the scenes. Those we honor tonight represent truly outstanding District of Columbia professionals who demonstrate the best in public service. In the applications that this award program received, we see a large spectrum of excellence. Tonight's winners certainly represent the breadth of talent in the District of Columbia departments. In particular, they are Alam Al-Alami, Operations Manager, Capital Construction Division, Department of General Services; Natalie Mayers, Agency Fiscal Officer, Department of Employee Services; Dr. Tonya Faust-Mead, Integrity Coordinator, Office of the State Superintendent of Education; John Thomas, Associate Director and State Forester, Urban Forestry Administration, District Department of Transportation; and Beatrice Willer, Program Manager, Child and Family Services Agency. And I just wanted to comment, in tonight's handsome program book, which I think is really an outstanding publication, you will see detailed descriptions of their impressive accomplishments. The mission of our foundation is to improve the lives of residents in the Washington metropolitan area. We are proud to support a program that shines a light on the contributions of tonight's remarkable individuals. These innovative and caring municipal workers make the district a dynamic community for those who live and work in the region and a welcoming destination for visitors. We thank all of the winners for your commitment day in and day out to transform our community in positive ways. Thank you very much.
All right, let me tell you a little bit about the awards program as we move into our program. The Cafritz Awards Program was established in the year 2000, and actually I'm pleased to note that several of the people who helped to initiate the program and to get it off the ground are also here tonight, so it's good to see them here. This is our 13th program, and we also have a number of past winners here. If you are a previous winner, would you please stand up? Will the previous winners please stand up who are here? Thank you all for coming. And we had another winner who was here earlier but had to go back to his school to help to quell some pending gang violence. So we wish him well and Godspeed. So thank you all for coming. It's impressive to see you here, and it's great to know that you continue to support the program. Now, the other thing is that how does this happen? All of the people that you see here today are nominated. They can self-nominate, but most of them are nominated by their coworkers. They're nominated by community members. They're nominated by other people in other agencies who know their work. And so their nominations are then submitted to our center, and we then follow up with each nominee to see if they would like to follow through on the process and put together a nomination portfolio, which is quite substantial. This year, as Mr. Cafritz said, we had over 300 nominees. What happens is those nominees are then, each application is reviewed by two and sometimes three screeners. Each is scored, and if there's any disparity in scoring, then we have a fourth person read that application. After the initial screening process, then we take the 20 or so finalists, and this year we had 23 finalists, and the finalists are then go to a selection panel. The selection panel reads all 23 portfolios, and then is faced with the daunting task of coming to a meeting to decide the five winners. And after two or three, sometimes more exhausting hours of back and forth, we usually reach a consensus on our winners. So it's quite an extensive process that begins, that actually will begin tonight. So our 2015 program actually will start tonight, and I'll explain that in a second. But it's quite a process that goes over a period of many months of work behind reaching the five winners and the number of finalists that we have. The criteria that we use is that we look for people who have solved an extraordinary problem or achieved a significantly difficult goal. They performed an outstanding act which brought positive recognition to the city. They successfully initiated and implemented an innovative idea that brought about dramatic results. They consistently achieved excellence in overall job performance that is above and beyond the call of duty. And they demonstrated outstanding and inspirational leadership that dramatically improved employee morale and team spirit. And as you meet our finalists, as you meet our winners, you will notice that most of them, in fact, qualified in three or four categories. So it's that level of outstanding contribution that we're recognizing this evening. Each of the winners will receive a number of prizes. They will receive a $7,500 cash award. In addition to that, they will receive a beautiful Tiffany plate and a number of other mementos. The finalists all receive a wonderful embossed certificate and that they have received this evening. So it's a substantial program and a substantial award. Our next speaker I'd like to introduce is the Director of Human Resources for the District of Columbia, and that's Ms. Shawn Stokes. And it has been my privilege to work with her and to partner with her on a number of initiatives. She is a very creative leader. She's a strategic thinker. She's not afraid to jump into the deep water of culture change and organization change. And so she's really lifted the spirits of her organization, and they're doing really big and wonderful things. And it's just a privilege for our center to be associated with her and the things that she's doing. She has a long career in public service. Prior to being appointed director of the DC Department of Human Resources in April of 2011, Shawn served as the chief human capital officer for the Baltimore City Public Schools. Also, she was the acting chief of staff with the Philadelphia School District. Shawn's commitment to human resources and improving organization effectiveness have led her to the District of Columbia government. And where, as I mentioned, she's just providing outstanding leadership. Please welcome Director Shawn Stokes.
Thank you, Jim. As you were saying that, I was like, who's he talking about? So it was really, really very kind words. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations. That sounds better to the winners and finalists of the 13th annual Cafritz Awards. I think many of you know, because I see so many colleagues and family, that these winners and finalists just contribute so much to the goal of one city. You definitely are examples of the kind of individuals we want to emulate. So thank you for all that you do, and it's going to be a wonderful celebration tonight. I think for this year, it's even more exciting for me because we are recognizing DCHR. We actually have a finalist this year. And I'd like Cheryl to stand, if you would, just because you have to know who she is. You probably saw her picture, right? not only is Cheryl a finalist, I don't know, Cheryl, we've tried this in the past, and it was just nice to see you this year. So thank you. And you probably may or may not know, Cheryl is the lead coordinator of the Cafritz Foundation Award. So she not only, you know, is a finalist, she actually is very instrumental in putting this together. So that just kind of shows you the type of leadership she has and continues to display. DCHR partners with the George Washington University Center for Excellence in Public Leadership and the Cafritz Foundation, who has been a wonderful partner to the district government, of course, to GW, to promote the Cafritz Awards. Because we see the importance of recognizing outstanding public servants such as yourselves. And you're going to continue to hear this over and over and just take it in. Grab every time you hear it. Why is this important to have your support for the people in this room, as well as, I would say, your family or friends? It's important because the winners and finalists that are being recognized bring such a positive energy and positive recognition to the city by solving difficult problems and achieving many goals which many may believe to be, what I would say, impossible. And, you know, in their write-ups, you probably see they're going the extra mile, not sometimes, not when they feel like it. They're doing it consistently and all the time. So, you know, that's why you're being, you know, recognized tonight for all the hard work and dedication that you've shown the city over many years. To the agency directors, and I believe I do have some agency directors in the room, could you please stand? I know that. Could you stand, please? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It's good to know who's in here. I have a couple of personnel matters I need to talk about. That's good. That's good. So to the agency directors, DC government employees and the audience, this is what you can do. Nominate a deserving employee. The Cafritz Award website, you can Google it or you can write it down now. CafritzAwards.org, www, of course, for more details if you want to learn about who qualifies for something like this. And I really challenge you to walk away and at least visit the site if you haven't already. It doesn't take more than a couple of minutes. Especially when you're nominating someone who has done outstanding work, you don't have to find the words. They come very easily. So spread the word throughout your agency, specifically the agency directors. Please do that, as well as the staff in the room today, so that we can continue to have this type of audience. And most importantly, I'd like to thank the Morris and Gwendolyn Cafritz Foundation for sponsoring the awards program and for its tireless commitment to improve the quality of life for residents of the Washington, D.C. area, because that is the public and that's who we serve. So thank you so much for your continued support. So thank you again, and I'm looking forward to giving out some certificates and these lovely awards back here. Thank you.
All right, we're going to recognize the finalists, and I will tell you how this will work. Before doing that, however, let me just clarify one thing, is that when I mentioned the screening committee and the selection panel, no DC employee is allowed to serve on either of those screening or selection committees. Those are done entirely by people who are outside of DC government. Now, here's how we're going to do this. I'm going to announce the finalists. We have 18 finalists. I'm going to announce their names. When I announce your name as a finalist, will you please stand and remain standing? Their pictures will appear on the screen, and you are welcome to applaud and salute them as their names are called and as they stand. We're going to start with Nicole Cobbs Stearns. Deidre Kogan. Sarah Connell. Yeah. Rayshawn Crossan. Gareen Doss. Dr. Aurora Delispin Jones. Cheryl Durden. And Cheryl, I'm assuming they are, that's not all family, right? I'm just trying to, okay. Charlene Fairfax. Betty McNeil Green. Maurice Henderson. Jacqueline Aiken Nosette. Carla Jardin Okonkwo. Carla's not here tonight. Alberta Paul. Paul, who's not here tonight. The aforementioned Cheryl Robertson. More big families. Lindsay Rohrbaugh, not here tonight. Rochelle Wilson. And Jean Ellen Weich. You may be seated. Congratulations to all of you. Now we're going to introduce you to our five winners and give you an idea of how this will work. I will say the name of the winner. We will then show you a video bio of the winner, and then the winner will be invited to the stage for some picture taking, and then we'd like to have some remarks from each of the winners. Let's start with Alam Al-Alami, who is the operational manager of the Capital Construction Division, Department of General Services.
A veteran of the D.C. government, Alam Al-Alami took the lead in overseeing two of the district's largest public safety projects, the Unified Communications Center and the Consolidated Forensic Laboratory.
Very few district workers have been able to stay with the district for at least over 15 years, which is something, you know, I mean, very few of us can say that.
What drives Alam to continue in service with the D.C. government?
We have an impact on our community that we live in.
Alam epitomizes what project management is all about. And not very many project managers have that kind of background, that kind of experience, that kind of training.
Coordinating multiple agencies and project teams, sometimes with competing roles and missions, requires leadership, ingenuity, and talent as a team builder in order to be successful.
It's not just a shell and, you know, interiors. It is a building with tons and tons of complicated equipment in there. So you can imagine when you have to coordinate and manage all these various people, you know, consultants, you know, in the realization of this project, I think that is a calling.
He corrals everybody to doing, like, to getting the mission done and basically saves the day.
Alam has been one very good mentor, not only to me, to several of us, you know, that frankly we are aspiring that at some point, you know, in our profession, we'll be able to do a project of that size, of that complexity, like the CFL.
I would hesitate to call it DC CSI, but the Consolidated Forensic Lab is about as close as I've seen in real life to what you get on TV. This building is state of the art. It is the pinnacle of forensic facilities that I have seen today.
This award-winning facility co-locates the Department of Forensic Sciences, the Office of the Chief Medical Examiner, and MPD's crime scene investigations. It embodies such innovative features as a 30,000 square foot green roof and a coated glass skin to reduce the heat load on the building.
We have already documented that this building is saving at least 30% on the annual energy cost, you know, to the city. They do sum up to about $600,000 a year.
Alam feels particularly proud of these projects, which allow the city to build capacity and become a leader in innovation.
For many years, we used to outsource, a lot of our DNA testing, as an example, to the federal government, to the FBI labs. You know, now we brought that workload back into the city.
I think it's taught me one thing, to be very humble. You know, I think that Alam is somebody that doesn't have any air about him. He's very simple. Regardless of the fact that he's done so much, you know, not only in his life, but in the city and for the city.
He doesn't take the credit for it. He just does it without really needing an award. And I think that this is the reason why he's so deserving of it, is because he's now really getting the recognition that he does deserve.
I mean, I'm older than him, so I won't say I want to grow up to be like a lamb. But I wish that if I have a chance to do it again, I would want to be like a lamb.
Alami, please.
Yeah, we know how to build buildings, but we don't get training on public speaking. Yes. Maybe we should do that program, June. Thank you really for this kind introduction. Good evening, everyone. First and foremost, I would like to thank God for allowing me to stand here in front of you today as one of the recipients of this year's Cafritz Award, Excellence in Public Service. I am very honored and humbled for being selected as one of the winners, and it happens also to come on my 15-year anniversary working for this great city. Thank you. I believe that my selection is a testament to and recognition of all of the great work we perform at the Department of General Services on a daily basis. While these two projects featured in the introduction, the Unified Communication Center and the Consolidated Forensic Lab, brought national and international recognition to the city, and each won multiple awards. We have over 80 DGS professional individuals in the Capital Construction Division, made up of employees and consultants, performing an outstanding job and making a difference on a daily basis in elevating the quality of life in the district. DGS Capital Construction Division is managing over 140 projects with an annual capital budget of around $400 million. Whether it is a new school being built, a fire engine being renovated, a neighborhood park being upgraded, a homeless shelter being modernized, a new satellite DMV station service center being launched, or a new office suite being built, a professional DGS team member is there. Our director and my friend, Brian Hanlon, launched a project a couple of years ago called Elevate. If you have been on our DGS website or receive a business card from a DGS employee, you would have noticed the Elevate campaign on it. Elevate is a commitment to excellence. That is what we aspire to do at DGS on a daily basis as we elevate our commitment to our client agencies to elevate our delivery to our ultimate clients, the DC residents. Now I need to give a few rounds of thanks. First, I'd like to thank Mayor Gray for his leadership and vision. Also our city administrator, Mr. Alan Liu, and the deputy mayor for public safety and justice, Paul Quander, for their support Both of these projects fell under the Deputy Mayor for Public Safety and Justice. I also like to thank DGS Director Brian Hanlon for his leadership to move this agency forward. I also like to thank DGS Deputy Director for Capital Construction, Ms. June Locker, for her commitment and support and for nominating me for this award. I also like to thank the directors of the Department of Forensic Sciences, Dr. Max Hawk, and his Chief Operating Officer, Ms. Yiro Chen, for submitting letters of support on my behalf for this award. I also like to thank the entire DGS Capital Construction Division, the A-Team. Let me hear it. When the UCC was completed, I was then working at the Office of the Chief Technology Officer. And I'd like to thank the current OCTO Director, Rob Mancini, and also one of the prior directors, Ms. Suzanne Peck. She was kind enough to come here tonight, whose commitment to excellence was one of the drivers for the success of the UCC project. I also like to acknowledge the project architect, Irena Sabakova. She's here tonight with us. She's the person who kind of, you know, drew that beautiful building, designed it. I also like to thank the project team members from both the UCC and CFL who came here today to share in the celebration. This award is also a recognition of their hard work and commitment. Finally, I'd like to thank my dear family. Where's the water? Finally, I'd like to thank my dear family for their support and understanding, my wife, Randa, my children, Noor, Waleed, and Aya. Recognizing excellence in public leadership is a great program that should be duplicated across the nation. On that note, I truly like to thank Mr. Cafritz and the Morris and Gwendolyn Cafritz Foundation for supporting this great program, along with the George Washington University. I'd like also to congratulate the other four winners and the finalists for their accomplishments. Finally, a special thank to Kate. You know, Kate is the Cafritz Award Program Director with the George Washington University. This looked like, you know, preparing for a wedding, you know what I mean? So all the rehearsal we had to do and all that, so, you know. Anyway, thank you all, and have a great evening. Thank you.
That was awesome. I felt like honored and humbled, you know, to be selected. Actually, you know, I probably had more joy when I learned that I, you know, made the short list, kind of the final list, where they cut it to 21 individuals. So then, you know, to come back, you know, a week, 10 days later, to learn that, you know, I actually made one of the five winners, it feels awesome, you know. Feels awesome. It's, you know, it's a, you know, I take that as a recognition of what we do at our agency, the Department of General Services. We really do some awesome stuff as an entire, you know, agency.
Our next winner is Natalie Mayers. She's the agency fiscal officer for the Department of Employment Services.
When Natalie came on board at the Department of Employment Services in 2012, the agency was suffering from low morale.
One of the challenges that the agency was facing that time, Department of Labor put the hierarchy in the agency, and also there was $8.8 million disallowances that we have to pay back to the federal government.
So we developed a strategic corrective action plan that has taken us from huge numbers of liabilities with the federal government to really being in a place where our work is respected, where we've been able to resolve a number of corrective action items that we were cited on, and even mitigating the risk of the amount of monies that we've had to return to the federal government.
And under the HEL leadership, we were able to recoup $5.1 million.
And so there is definitely this sense that because of Natalie's work, that the agency has a level of credibility on a national level that was not here before.
In 2009, Natalie was recruited to become the agency fiscal officer at the Department of Real Estate Services now the Department of General Services. Despite an understaffed office and a tight deadline, she led a massive financial consolidation involving her agency and five others in creating a $1 billion agency budget.
What was awesome about that experience, I must say, is that at no point, and we were a team of five, created that budget in under 6 weeks and had it balanced. We had to work with every financial officer in all those different agencies. We had to work with the Central Budget Office. I never once had to ask my staff to work on the weekends. They just did. The whole energy that I try to bring to the table is what we're looking for is the solution. There always will be problems. Just figure out how we're going to approach them, and we can do it together. I am a working manager, meaning that there is nothing that is beneath me to do. If we are staying late, then we're all going to stay late. We're going to figure out how to resolve the issue.
Myself and my staff were in a meeting with Natalie right before the budget hearing, and we're like, we are going to have to either remove staff from the staffing plan and or cut the amount of participants that we serve. And she said, wait a minute. She said, I have an idea. Now, you have your chief financial officer saying that they're going to call another department to see if they can negotiate funds to come into your program. My team was just like, we can't believe she did that. And I'm like, well, it is Natalie we're talking about. That's just the way she is.
To give back has always been a thing that my mom has constantly told me. And I think that's the essence of what government is, that you are in a role not just to crunch numbers, you know, or pay bills or prepare a budget, but in the end, it is to ensure that you are helping others.
I've been in this business for a very long time, and you don't meet folks with that passion for the vision, not that passion to say, I'm going to be a part of the solution. I am not just going to tell you the rules of engagement, but I'm going to be in it with you.
And it's just a great honor to have someone from the CFO's office, you know, of all the people in the District of Columbia, to get that award. And she definitely deserves it for all the hard work she's done. So I'm very, very proud of her and very happy for the office, for the district, and for her, for all the hard work she's done.
Hi.
Let me just get my notes out. So, I stand here before you truly blessed in more ways than you could count. And when I look out at this room and see my family, can't tell you how touched and pleased I am. And when I talk about my family, I'm not just talking about my biological family, but my work family, because you are my family. And I appreciate each and every one of you. I want to say thanks be to God for how blessed he has his blessings unto me. Too many to number. I want to thank the Cafritz Foundation for having this ceremony and having this session so that we can honor people like yourselves. I want to thank all of the finalists who are winners and the final five, and I'm so honored to be a part of you today. You know, when I was asked to go to Department of Employment Services and serve as the agency fiscal officer, I was a little bit hesitant, I must say. I was. I'm a mom of wonderful little people, and you know, it's difficult sometimes when you're a mom of young children to accept certain roles. But my husband talked about it, we talked about it together, and he said, you know what? What's for you is for you, and you have my support. So I thank you for that, dear. I want to thank my sister, Suzette, who is an awesome individual, and who, without her, I would not be here, because she was the one nagging me to death. Could you please fill out your application? And she edited and re-edited. But more than that, this position requires very long hours sometimes. And she has been that second mother to my children to ensure everything still stayed where it should be. So I am awesomely blessed. The story of being able to create the budget for DGS and work in Department of Employment Services and make some of the strides that we were able to make is none other than being able to establish strong relationships. I stand here not as an individual, but as many. When I call, when I pick up the phone, when I send an email, whether it's to Felix Linderman and Octo or Sandy Pinter in the Office of the Chief Information Officer and all the team that is with them, whether it's Carla Kirby and DCHR, wherever these people may be, when I call, they answered. So I stand here not by myself, but behind me there are many. I want to give particular credit to the team that helped build the budget for DGS, Dwight Jones, Corey Miller, Brandon Solomon, and Nasser Muhammad, who worked tirelessly to do that when it had been not done before. And the level of the scale of that activity, I can't even begin to tell you. I owe much to them. To my current team, the team of five that started with Department of Employment Services, Tish, Shannon, Kwame, Brian, Terrell, Antoinette, you did it. Whatever I asked, you stepped up and you did it, and you argued with me when I was wrong, and I thank you for that. One of the benefits of being a good manager or a good leader, a good friend, is having people tell you when you're making a mistake and being able to listen. So I thank you for that. I've learned so much in my tenure in the District of Columbia, and being part of an awesome office of the Chief Financial Officer, what I've learned is it's not us against them. Sometimes when you're working
OCFO program,
you know, there's this delicate tension. It's us against them. And it's not us, it's we. We serve the district residents. We work together to make it happen. And when you remove barriers, great things can happen. For those of you that I forgot to mention by name, I love you. I thank you for everything you have ever done for me. I appreciate you in so many ways. I thank you, Mom, for always being there for me, for being steadfast, for being true, for pushing me when I needed to be pushed. I thank the CPM program for making me the mayor. I think that was Jim or Natalie. And it was the most difficult simulation I had ever been through at that point. But today, everything that led up to this prepared me for where I am today. So I thank you all.
It's awesome. It feels so wonderful being recognized through this CAFITS Foundation. And I'm so pleased to represent all the people that have worked with me and are working with me.
Our next winner is Dr. Tanya Faust-Mead. She is the Integrity Coordinator for the Office of the State Superintendent of Education.
In 2010 and 2011, the District of Columbia was facing allegations of massive educator fraud. Media coverage by USA Today, NPR, and other news outlets focused attention on an unusual number of erasures on standardized tests that took place in dozens of DC schools several years before.
There was a negative perception, there was an implication that urban kids located in the District of Columbia attending public school systems did not have the capacity, did not have the intellectual capabilities to succeed academically. In each instance, there was this feeling that the only way that students in the District of Columbia could achieve academic success was through educator cheating and misconduct. And I knew that wasn't true.
In 2012-13, the school received findings for a high number of wrong to right erasures on our test assessment, which meant that it was a peculiar number of students who would erase the wrong answer and move it to a correct answer. It's a statistic, it's a ratio, but it was a finding for the previous school year. So with that, we were put as a critical finding, and they required both OSSE and the charter school board that we serve, or that serves us, required that we do corrective action around those pieces, which can create a hostile environment and can also create the opportunity for OSSE or the integrity person to be seen as an enemy. We were lucky enough to see Tanya as a resource that she is.
What Dr. Mead has done is really create a multi-level program for knowing how to investigate, when to investigate, at what points to investigate.
With a solid Test Integrity Act, the policies and procedures and training and coaching and mentoring and outreach, the focus becomes less on enforcement and compliance and more on what's happening in the classroom.
Yeah, she's the integrity person, security person. She's the end all when you're talking about corrective action when you do something wrong. But she takes the time to make sure that you've had all the preparation, that you've had all the support.
And by investigating and monitoring these test irregularities, residents, teachers are able to know that the scores that we have on how students perform in school, that they're accurate, that they're giving us honest information by which we can go further design educational programs to ensure that our students are performing at their very top levels.
What I see from a social justice background, from not just being effective, but actually making change happen, is seeing that when assessments have integrity and they're secure, you see that the students are validated in the environment, that adults haven't impacted the opportunity for that student to get services, to get support. That is a large task when you're talking about the folks that she serves.
She really gave kids an opportunity for greater academic excellence.
Good evening, everyone. I looked at the video and I'm like, oh man, I'm so nervous. thank you, your welcoming smiles, your generosity. Thank you, Mr. Cafritz and the Cafritz Foundation, for this honor. I'm so grateful, particularly for the DC residents, the parents, the families, and the students who believed in me, believing in them. And that's why I go to work every day, is because sometimes there's a lot of negativity in the air. And kids can sense that negativity. Parents can sense that negativity also. But if you shine your light, be yourself, and realize that, hey, the light can dispel the darkness. And that's what I do at my job every day, is I'm dispelling the darkness. And I want to particularly mention my Uber boss, who I believe is with us today, Jesus Aguirre. The State Superintendent of Education. He has provided a dynamic environment whereby, sure, we are bureaucrats and public servants, but if an individual has a solution to the problem, no matter what title, no matter what grade, CS9, CS10, CS11, he's there to push us forward. I'd also like to recognize my colleague, who's also a winner. Please stand. Ms. Rayshawn Crossan. I think many don't realize how valuable it is for, I want to call myself a youngster. I've been with the DC system for almost 8 years. I believe Ms. Crossan has been with the Office of the State Superintendent of Education since its establishment. And the younger kids, I'd like to say I'm a little bit younger, but I'm not really. We always look to the veterans. And when I look out into the crowd and I see so many public servants representing all of the DC agencies, just remember,
that we're watching you, and we are so appreciative of what you do. And now let me get to my notes. I apologize. I am grateful to my husband, Dorian Mead. I'm grateful to John Davis, the chief of schools for DCPS. He actually helped me realize that it's not all about you when you're a public servant. It's about others. I'd like to recognize Darian Nicely, who was represented on the video, China Terrell, also, who is the advisory neighborhood commissioner for Mount Pleasant. I'd like to recognize and thank all of the school principals, the school teachers, the leaders, for just doing an excellent job with testing this year. Thank you.
I'm really excited. I first heard about the award when I was selected, and my mother-in-law called me up. She said, Tanya, did you realize you won? I said, what are you talking about? And this was even before I received the notification from the director of the program. So I'm just thrilled to be able to receive acknowledgement for the good work that I've done for D.C. residents.
Next, I'd like to recognize Mr. John Thomas, who's the Associate Director of the Urban Forestry Administration.
Since John Thomas came to the district's Urban Forestry Administration 11 years ago, the program grew in staffing and budget, making an ever bigger green imprint on the D.C. community. Since 2005, UFA has planted 55,000 trees to increase the city's tree canopy cover to 37%.
John has taken the challenge of reaching the mayor's goal of 40% urban tree canopy incredibly seriously. And the need for a city to develop and our desire to preserve the tree canopy, street and otherwise, are often at odds, and so it's a real accomplishment for him to be able to have implemented the primary program that achieves the goal of enhancing and maintaining the existing tree canopy.
The benefits of a larger tree canopy or expanding tree canopy are numerous. DC has a lot of stormwater issues where we have a very polluted river, the Anacostia, which is getting filled up with sediment. Trees help slow down how much water is getting to that system and how fast it gets there. We have really high rates of childhood asthma. One of their strengths is making air quality better so that people can breathe and some of the toxins are out of the air.
Street trees are what humanize a city. They bring nature back to a city. They provide scale in the built environment. And under John's leadership, we've been able to both preserve and enhance these natural assets that make our city much more livable, both for the people that live here and the people that visit.
The Urban Forestry Administration thus not only helped further the mayor's sustainability goal, but has also allowed the district to become a showcase for urban forestry management.
We have a very dynamic and complex GIS work system where we have every tree captured in an inventory and we're able to analyze the tree, the size, the species, the condition.
It was John's decision to move us towards a full GIS-based inventory system, and at the time it was a difficult adjustment for all of the arborists on staff, but now fast forward 8 years and his vision in that decision has really paid off. So whether it's the well-maintained tree inventory that we have and that we maintain every day, to just the volume of work that we deliver, the resources we have at our disposal, all of which John has been instrumental in securing.
Working with trees specifically and trying to develop a canopy for the city and instill that love of nature and that understanding of nature with citizens, where we can try to explain to people or show people the importance of trees in our environment and all the benefits that they bring.
He said, I have an idea. With every tree that you plant, would you agree to install a regulation tree box fence? And he said, well, it's second in importance only to water for the survival of the tree. And nobody ever thought about soil compaction. John is a very modest person, and he never toots his own horn. And I think he's done so much to improve the Urban Forestry Administration.
Future generations are going to be very happy that we took this time to make sure the trees are healthy and that we're putting more trees in, because it's not for today, it's trees are always for tomorrow.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming out to support all of us, district government employees. I don't think it's great to get recognition. We work hard, and it's not always seen, and it's great to finally have all these people here in front of us who are seeing the great work we do. First, I'd like to thank Mr. Cafritz and the Morris and Gwendolyn Cafritz Foundation for acknowledging district employees and their efforts to improve the city. It is an honor to receive this award, and is greatly appreciated. And it's very humbling to receive this. It's a huge morale boost for staff, our program, myself. It's great to be recognized for something that you love to do. I'd also like to thank Matt Brown, our DDOT's director. He's the best boss anyone could ask for, and even better as he cares very deeply about our program and what we're doing. He's great. I'd have to start with first thanking my family, who has to deal with all the phone calls, the emails, the sleepless nights, the wind, the snow, everything. My wife, Kirsten, who's the most capable person I know, she provides endless support when I need help, and without her, I wouldn't be here tonight. My daughters, Sophia and Nadia, who are here tonight, who help out when I'm gone for days after a hurricane or a snow event, and they're left home trying to figure out how to get power on, saves food in the refrigerator. You guys are the best. Next, the staff at UFA who really deserve this. This is not about me. This is really about them. They're the hardest working group of employees that I've ever met. They've been integral to our success. They've accepted the challenges that we've put upon them and ran with it. And without that, we wouldn't be here. UFA staff really makes coming to work every day exciting. I get up, I'm ready to come to work, and it's partly and mostly because they're really good people to work with. Specifically from UFA, I got to thank Earl Utzer, who has been instrumental in making every day more successful than the last. It's been challenging, and we're finally, I think, at the top of the hill and getting a chance to look around for the first time in 10 years. And one last person that we want to remember, Regina Richardson, who was a UFA member who passed away this year, and she was a very special member of our team and one of my first hires, actually, and we want to remember her. We want to thank all the nonprofit groups that help UFA accomplish our goal. We don't do this alone. We do this with everybody, and trees need everybody. And they play a key role in expanding it, and in particular, Mark Viscano from Casey Trees, who not only keeps us in check, but also supports us. And it's critical to have someone who's there as a partner, but also there making sure that we're moving in the right direction. Quickly, I want to thank John McGaw, Jose Colon, and Shoma Day, who took the time to write letters of recommendation and provided guidance during this process. Without them, their guidance was greatly appreciated. And also Betsy Ames for Trees for Georgetown, who's a great partner to UFA. And a true champion for trees. She's always out on the street trying to educate people and on the importance of trees. And my last plug for urban forestry, trees are important to every city. They support habitat, they improve communities, and they provide many environmental benefits and help frame our neighborhoods. And in DC, we have to thank LaFont for his plan and Boss Shepherd for his massive tree planting many, many years ago. And what they did is reserve spaces for us now to put trees back in. And without that space being kept, we wouldn't be able to have the trees that we have in the District of Columbia. But so thank you all for coming out and supporting the winners, the finalists. I want to thank them. And to Kate and Jason, who made this process really, really fun. It was exciting, and I learned a lot. Thank you for everyone.
I guess I was surprised when I made the first cut, and then wasn't really thinking about the second cut. But when I saw it, I was, I think it's great that someone's honoring public servants and all the stuff that we do, and all the things that we have to to get them done, what we have to go through to get them done. And it's typically a thankless job, and this is great that someone's decided to make this a focus. It's really rewarding, and it's a great morale booster for staff and everyone to see that
you know, your hard work does pay off.
Our next winner is Beatrice Willier. She's a program manager for the Child and Family Services Agency.
Beatrice first came to CFSA to head the Office of Volunteer Services, but it has expanded into something much bigger.
And what we found is that a lot of people may not have an opportunity to be a foster parent or be an adoptive parent, but they do want to help and be in the lives of children, and thus Partners for Kids in Care was born.
Partners for Kids in Care, or PFK, is a broad community and corporate outreach initiative that generates in-kind and monetary donations to the tune of $400,000 a year.
She started by really reaching out to businesses. She created a board of amazing people who are connected to all sorts of businesses and civic groups, and her vision just kept growing from there.
We sat down in our conference room right down the hall and met to kind of brainstorm. Like, what can we do? How can we in the business community help you out more?
The donation center is really the centerpiece of our activities. And so when young people come into this room, it's incredible. We have this beautiful mural behind me, which is my favorite piece. We had a local artist come in and create it. And when they come in, they feel the magic of this room. So when they come in, they don't feel like they're getting hand-me-downs, and that they truly understand that everything in here is of a high-quality nature. And we did that purposefully because we want them to know that they are special and that they are deserving of things like that.
And in many other child welfare systems, it's really unfortunate, but kids travel with garbage bags. And we did not want that for our kids in foster care. So one of the first partnerships that be established was with an organization that provided luggage. And it's such a simple thing, but that we made a commitment that our children would not travel with garbage bags, and they deserve that dignity.
Bringing community involvement allows Partner for Kids to support around 16 different programs and services throughout the year, ranging from books and toy drive, back to school drives, and one of CFSA's most successful initiatives, the Prom Project. What originally started as a donation drive for prom dresses expanded to tuxedos, rides to the prom, hairstyling services, and much more.
The fashion show that helps, you know, not only create a great event for the kids to be a part of, but also an incredible learning experience for the kids to gain confidence that they probably never had. Beatrice is the lifeline of Partners for Kids. She started it. She is the drive behind it. These things that happen that's not luck. She's worked very hard to make this happen.
The reach and the impact has been twofold. I think one has been that we've been able to open our arms to people who want to do something good for kids in foster care, and then also certainly the impact for children who are in foster care.
We were dropping off toys at what was the old offices, and we were there unloading, and we're in the back of a garage. It's a cold December day, and somebody just walking by looked and said, "Oh, this is just wonderful." She goes, "It's just so nice to know that somebody cares." People do care. And for these kids to know this, these less fortunate kids who were thrown into circumstances beyond their control, to know that people within the system and out of the system truly care, it really gives value to what Beatrice has created.
Oh my goodness, thank you so much. I'm holding back tears. They may come. I started with CFSA about 11 years ago, and it started as a job. And then it progressed as a career, and then it became my passion. And I remember, I'm speaking all out of turn, I have my notes. And I remember when I first started, let me backtrack a bit. I definitely want to recognize someone who's an extraordinary leader. Our CFSA director, Ms. Brenda Don, I want her to stand. And she has just been such a mentor and role model for me, always pushing me. When I first met her, I was shy. And I remember my first evaluation, she put, you know, B is smart, she has great ideas, but she's too reticent. I was like, darn, you know, you want to get that A and I got the B. So then next, you know, I found my voice. And then the next evaluation, she was like, okay, we can't shut her up. And so Brenda pushes you for greatness. She's an extraordinary leader. She sets the bar very high, and she has a fierce drive for excellence. And so one of my first challenges was a big one. I needed to change the way the policies and the laws around the way the agencies accepted donations. And of course, we had to go right to the top, to the mayor's office. And so I worked, I made my pitch, and was able to convince them to change. And now the policy that we changed back then, the district uses it now. And when I met with the general counsel, her name was Polly Rich at the time, and she, after the meeting, she said, "Are you an attorney?" And I said, "No, I'm not." And she said, "Well, you missed your calling." And I paused and I said, "Well, I may not be in the courtroom, but I've definitely found my calling." And so I want to thank, and I remember watching one time a documentary with Muhammad Ali called When We Were Kings, and they credited him with creating one of the shortest poems. And the poem simply goes, "Me, we." And that is the spirit in which I accept this award today. I want to definitely thank Mr. Cafritz and his wonderful family, the Cafritz Foundation, and their wonderful legacy of giving. That is really something very profound, and thank you so much for that. I'd like to thank all of my colleagues who are family at CFSA. They work so hard. I want to thank all of the finalists, but especially I want to thank my family at CFSA. I want all of them to stand, Nicole, Cheryl, and Jean. I know them all very well. And they are consummate professionals and very, very dedicated. At this time, I do want to thank my team. We are a team of three, but we make three look like 300. And I want to recognize Catrice Pitts and Angela Robinson. They are extraordinary women, and they are just incredible. I mean, we work from a creative aesthetic, and we bounce ideas around, off of each other, and each one takes the lead on all the many programs. And we don't stop until we get it right. And then once we get it right, our little mantra is we drop the mic. Bam! So I can't drop the mic today. But I want to thank you so much for all of your hard work and dedication. It is such a joy to work with women who are so driven and who work with purpose and who are believers. Because I think at the heart of it, we are believers in that we are the believers in the good of people, in the good of our children. Next, I want to thank our Partners for Kids board, who is so extraordinary. I have two board members. Forgive me if there's more here. I want to absolutely thank Annalisa Asadi. I want her to stand. And Larilia Arrington, I want her to stand. And these, again, are extraordinary people who work with us throughout the year. So these are people who have donated, but then they said we wanted to do more. And without them, we could not have had the success that we've had. And I definitely want to thank Marty Janis, our board chair, people like Bert Braverman, who's a pillar, Doug Norwood, other people that their names are escaping me, but they are definitely in my heart. And I really want to thank them because it does give us an opportunity not just to think outside the box, but think outside the building, where we literally go to K Street. And, you know, I may come with one or two ideas, and I leave with about 10 different ways to make it happen. Before I close, I definitely want to recognize my parents who are here, Charles Peterson and Eva Marie. I want to thank them so much for their love and support and always pushing me to be great. And these are the most generous people you can ever meet. And, you know, it's like the adage goes that you children learn not from what you say, but from what you do. And they've always opened their home and always opened their heart. When I was growing up, my dad, he would fix bikes for the kids, you know, go out and put the parts together. And so if anybody needed a bike, he would be there to provide one. So the fruit does not fall far from the tree. And so I want to thank you so much for your love and support and helping me to become the woman that I have become, but that I'm looking forward to becoming as well. And so in closing, I want to share one of my favorite quotes from the one and only phenomenal woman, Maya Angelou, and which goes, she said that people may forget what you say, they may forget what you do, but they'll never forget how you made them feel. And it is my fervent desire to make all children that are in foster care, that are in care, know that they are special and that their community cares about them. Thank you so much again for this wonderful honor. One of my board members had talked about nominating me, so I kind of, you know, knew that it was coming, but I was still so excited when I got the notification in the email about the nomination. We had the most finalists from CFSA, four finalists, so it was kind of tough because I didn't care about competing against the other agencies, but I didn't want to compete against my colleagues, but it was really fun.
Wow, congratulations to all of our winners and such diversity. We can build a building, we can get the kids to comply, we can make sure that nobody cheats, and we can put the trees in place to make everything work. So we got it all covered here tonight, so thank you. Next, Mayor Gray apologizes that he was not able to make it to tonight's gala. However, he still wanted to offer his congratulatory remarks.
Good evening, and welcome to the 13th Annual Morris and Gwendolyn Cafritz Foundation Awards for Distinguished D.C. Government Employees. I'm sorry I can't be with you tonight in person to welcome all of the attendees and to congratulate this year's Cafritz Awards recipients and nominees. The Cafritz Awards recognize exceptionally dedicated and innovative district government employees committed to the greater good of our city. These often unsung, behind-the-scenes heroes uphold the public interest each day amidst competing interests, pressures, and demands. Tonight, we give special thanks to the five extraordinary people who are the winners of this year's Cafritz Awards program. Also, to all nominees and district government employees, I say thank you and offer my appreciation for the good work you do each day to move our city forward. I would also like to express my appreciation for the continued generous support of the Cafritz Foundation that makes this program possible. As the mayor of the District of Columbia, I am pleased to be able to celebrate your accomplishments, because only by working together can we build a city that works for all. Once again, I offer my congratulations to tonight's award recipients, and I thank each of you for your dedication and exemplary service to our city.
Representing the university is Dr. Bernard Demchuk, who is the Assistant Vice President for District Relations. Bernard is particularly close to the center. He's an advisor to me. He is a guide, and he's been so supportive of our center. And some of you may know he's a scholar who has specialized in the history of the District of Columbia. Frequently loves to take people on tours of the district. He's a 40-year D.C. resident. He lives in the Shaw community, where he's been very active in labor, community, corporate, academic, and government relations. And he's been a longtime supporter of the Cafritz Awards program, so it's great to have him with us tonight.
Bernard. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Jim. Good evening.
Good evening.
Whoa, good evening. This is a great evening.
Yes.
Isn't this a great evening for the city of Washington, D.C., the government of the District of Columbia, for George Washington University, for the Cafritz Foundation, and especially for you and the winners. Congratulations, you guys. Just a marvel. You know, I started out, Jim, as a GS2 in 1971 at St. Elizabeth's Hospital at the John Howard Pavilion for the NGBRI. Not guilty by reason of insanity. I was at the John Howard Pavilion where they kept, you know, pretty rough guys and ladies. And I was the assistant recreation director as a GS2. This was before DS. We were still DC government employees. We were of the federal government back in 71. And the director of the recreation of St. E's got into trouble and got fired. And because I was the assistant director, I became the director. And I got promoted to a GS3. And, And I retired in 1998 with Marion Barry in the cabinet, so I went from a DS2 all the way up to the cabinet with Marion Barry. God bless Marion Barry. I bring you greetings from the George Washington University. No, I'm serious about Marion Barry, my friend and my boss for 20-some years. I bring you greetings from the George Washington University and also from our president, Stephen Knapp. And I want to thank you, and I want to mention Brian Hanlon and Jesus Aguirre and Jeffrey DeWitt and Brenda Donald, my old friend. Thank you, directors, for doing what you're doing and bringing us the best and the brightest. Thank you. You know, you are the guys who make this city run in the good times and the bad times, in the riots and in the recessions, in the crime sprees and in the Christmas calm. You're the guys that keep us going where our coffers are empty or we experience surpluses year after year. It doesn't matter what happens at the very top. You keep the city running. You keep it humming. You keep it serving. You keep it safe. You keep it calm. Imagine, remember that couple years ago when we had that series of earthquakes and killings and this, that, and floods and hurricanes? And the city just kept going. It's like never skipped a beat. It's because of the work that you have been doing all of these years professionally. And I just want to say thank you once again. It's been said thank you 100 times, should be 1,000 times, the Cafritz family and my dear friend Calvin Cafritz. And I want to tell you, the Cafritz family has been in this city for a long time. And what they're doing here tonight and for the last 13 years, they've been doing it in this city for the last 100 years. We want to thank you, Cafritz family. And I live in Shaw, as Jim said, and the Cafritz family started in Shaw, right down the street from where I live on 7th Street. And last but not least, let me just say, this has been an amazing group of winners. You are so beautiful. Alam Al-Alami, I've been practicing that name all afternoon. I think that's one of the great names in the city. Alam Al-Alami, I want to keep saying it over and over and over. I feel like you should be some kind of a hip-hop rap artist or maybe a shooting guard with the San Antonio Spurs or something. What a great name, you know. You know the story. I'm going to tell everybody else the story that you know. So one day there was a philosopher engineer who was walking on his site that he had just created. This beautiful, amazing building was going up by these masons, these brick masons. And he walks by this young brick mason and he says to the brick mason, "So, young man, what are you doing?" And the mason says, "Sir, I'm building this wall. Look how perfect it is. I got the slab, I got the mortar on it, I got the bricks, I got the lines, everything is just perfect." He goes, "Very good job, young man." Walks down to the next brick mason, he's a little bit older, and he says, "Sir, what are you doing?" He says, "Sir, I'm building a gorgeous building. I'm building a building that's going to be beautiful and straight, that's going to stand for 500 years. I'm so proud of what I'm doing." He says, "Good job, young man." He walks down around the corner, and he sees this old brick mason. He says, "Sir, what are you doing?" He says, "Sir, I'm building a building to the future. I'm building a building in honor of our children. I'm building a building of intellectual curiosity. I'm building a building that's going to stand forever as a monument to the genius of the American spirit." And Mr. Alam, you're not just building buildings. You're building public safety. You're building communications. You're building health care. You're building justice in our city, and we thank you for it, Mr. Alam. Dr. Tonya Faust Mead, four names there, and I like the first name best, Doctor. Doctor. It's not easy getting a PhD, is it? You know, integrity starts with our students. Thank you for helping our students be honest. I teach a school without walls. I've been my 11th year teaching at Walls, right here on campus. And I give my students 6 secret words for success. 6 secret simple words for success. Hard work, stay honest, and be nice. Those are the words to success. It may not make you Oprah, it may not make you LeBron James, but it's going to be successful. And the second group of that words, stay honest. Thank you for what you've been doing. Natalie Mayers open, innovative, creative, and personalized application to employees to own their own budget. Whoa. Jeffrey, did you get all that, Jeffrey? Muhammad, you got it all? Innovative, creative budgets. I like the idea of a creative budget. I do that all the time, and I get in trouble. But you're the fixer, and you've built trust in our city with the taxpayers because you've helped us fix our budget. Thank you, dear. Thank you. Beatrice Williar. How do you say that? Williar? Williar, of course. It's pretty easy. Loving and motivating our foster children. You know, to move with luggage of Louis Vuitton rather than trash bags. You know, let's give them Louis Vuitton, because they're more precious than the Prada that's inside those bags, okay? Good job. Thank you. And that other great American name, Alam, John Thomas. I like names. I'm into names, John. I'm a historian, and I'm into names, Jim, and they're important. And didn't we used to be called the Tree City? Back in the 1930s and 40s, we had the densest and the widest tree canopy in the nation. We were the Tree City. We lost that. We lost our roots. I've been wanting to say that all day. And with our roots, we lose our branches, we lose our vitality, we lose our future. John Thomas, thank you for what you're doing. And I just, last but not least, have to say, Jim Robinson and Sean Stokes, this is a great partnership with the university. And I love D.C. government employees, and I love you all, and thank you all for being here tonight.
Before we go to closing remarks, I do want to recognize some of my staff. I've been very blessed to have a phenomenal staff. And not only can I rely on them, but they provide direction, they're innovative, and all of that. And the person I would like to step forward is the director of our Cafritz Awards program, Kate Pitti Ratava. Kate, would you step forward so people can see you? Kate does a phenomenal, phenomenal job. And in the back, we have our associate director, Dr. Natalie Hopi Haddon, who's standing in the back. Near her is Samantha Luna, also, who is our office manager and manages our administration in the office, and a lot beyond that. You know how some people are just so good that other duties assigned just continues to grow because they're capable of doing it. She just does a phenomenal job. I think Jing Vergi Tien was here. She's still here in the back. Thank her for all that she does. And Rick Henry was here previously. I want to thank him all for all that he does as well. So thank you all for coming. I want to turn it over to Mr. Calvin Cafritz for closing remarks. Mr. Cafritz.
Well, again, I want to thank you all for coming. This has been a sensational evening and such a pleasure for us to be with you and to honor those people who have been the finalists and the runners-up. It's been a great evening, and I can't say how much it means to me and to the members of the board of the Cafritz Foundation and all of our staff to be able to participate with you and honor you in this special way, because you certainly deserve it. In closing, I'd like to acknowledge Bernie Jemchuk, who made some really spectacular remarks tonight. It was great fun listening to you and learning a little bit about what you do in the city. And we want to also thank Dean Ali Eskandarian and the George Washington University for their continuing support of our program. for administering the Cafritz Awards. We certainly thank the dynamic Jim Robinson, who's really been an inspiration to all of us. And he mentioned his team, of course, including the talented and resourceful Kate Piatabravova. Let me also extend our appreciation to Mayor Grade, Director Stokes, and the District of Columbia for their support. We are most honored that our distinguished guests were able to join us in saluting these outstanding D.C. government employees. I also want to thank everyone who has joined us tonight to help pay tribute to the extraordinary achievements of these creative and hardworking public servants. Again, congratulations to the winners, finalists, their families, and colleagues. We hope to see you at next year's Cafritz Awards for distinguished D.C. government employees. Thank you very much, and good evening.